Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I am your host, Billy Strachan. I am joined this week, I'm so excited about this episode, which could be part one of many, with the Granite City Ghostbuster himself, the red-haired warrior, Scotty Swift. Not anymore.
Look at me. My hair is like a natural colour. And now that I'm older, I've actually got grey and white through it. It's like...
So that's how you're going. I was going to say you're going to go for the grey-haired warrior, but it's...
I don't mind it, because, I mean, it's a part of getting older, but just because my hair's never been natural in 20 years, so during lockdown, it's the first time I haven't done anything with it, and it is almost 20 years, so I'm finding white in my beard. So I don't mind it, but it's a bit of a departure, but anyway.
I was shocked. I don't know if anyone's going to see that in the video, but I was like, my word. Brent Carter actually sent a question in saying, ask Scotty what he uses in his hair. Nothing.
Nothing anymore.
Get the spikiness, though.
It's a fructose gel, and but the fructose gel had like different levels of like I guess like spiking ability. So I would have like the 4 out of 6 because anything below or over didn't work. But they've stopped producing it and it's not in the shops. So I've been able to buy quantities off of eBay, and then I just have like a stack sitting, so that'll last me 6 months or whatever, but now the price is going up and up and up, so it's going to get to the point where I'm going to have to find another product to use, and I'm genuinely stressing because this is the only stuff, and also because my hair's dyed, it's got color in it, some of the gel stripped the color out, you know, and then you're leaving a mess in the ring, and no one needs that, so I'm panicking about finding a replacement.
So the longer the shows are off, the better, so you can source a replacement.
Exactly. I think I've got about 7 or 8 shows worth sitting when it's time to go. But after that, it's squeaky bum time.
After that, it'll be every so often. Be like, no, I'm just going to do a promo in the ring. I'll have a hat on at the same time. I don't need. I'll get injured, and then I'll be off for a couple of weeks. I'll be fine.
If you see me wearing hats, then you know why I'm wearing hats in the ring. It's like, why has he got a hat on? It's so weird. Odd.
So we're not even a minute in, and we've already spun off. So let's.
Sorry.
You warned me, and I was very much expecting this. But we'll start with the boring question, and then we can have some fun. So, how did you get into pro wrestling? What was your first moment that you came?
You see, my memories are all over the shop with that. I do vaguely remember being at my grandmother's when I was young, and the TV would be on like, all day, and World of Sport, it would be on. And I wouldn't know it was World of Sport. I would just know, oh, these guys are fighting. You know, I remember it being rounds and being confused by why are they fighting and why are they stopping and why are they starting again until I figured out, oh, it's a round system. I didn't know anyone. I remember the likes of Haystacks and Big Daddy because they were so big. But I couldn't appreciate the guys who were good at it. I didn't know. It was just, wow, watch this. But I do remember watching, I think it was a wrestling challenge. I remember it was Legion of Doom were teaming with, I think it was either Warrior or no, it was Davey Boy. It was Davey Boy Smith and Legion of Doom were coming out. I think they were just killing 3 job guys, whatever. And obviously, like, Davey Boy's huge. Legion of Doom is huge. They've got, like, the face paint and you know, the spikes. It was like, I was blown away by it. So I think that was the catalyst, seeing those 3 guys, like, I need to see more of this. And then bugging my friends who had Sky, because I never had Sky TV, because back then Sky TV was like a luxury. This is like 91. So pestering my friends to tape stuff for me. Sometimes they would, sometimes they wouldn't. Going around to theirs to watch like a Rumble. I remember watching the Rumble 91 and being blown away by it. And then we went out in the back garden and we had a Rumble. We had to throw each other over the fence. I'm like about 10 years old, don't know what I'm doing, no idea, still don't know what I'm doing. And it was like the back of 9, so it was getting dark, and basically we kept going until it was like pitch black. It's okay, time to go home now. So this never-ending rumble in the dark. So I was bitten, I was totally bitten at that point. And even though wrestling 91, 92 wasn't particularly like big in the schools in Aberdeen, wrestling was big. Because we had the sticker books, we're trading stickers in between like breaks and stuff. Undertaker was super popular among us. I think he might have been the most popular guy, actually. So even though American wrestling was a bit down in 92, in Aberdeen, especially with the group of people I was with, wrestling was like hot. It was big to us because we didn't know business was then. We didn't know. We just knew it was amazing. So I think that's my strongest memory is Rumble 91, watching that wrestling challenge with Davey Boy and Legion of Doom and just being, wow, what is this? You know?
That's the best. I think that's the best way to know about wrestling, even now, is not knowing about the ratings. I mean, I try and avoid that information as much as possible. I just want to watch the shows. So
spoilers and stuff, and
I mean, I just don't care. I just want to watch wrestling. I don't care.
I used to care. No, when you know, I think we all, some of us, go through that stage where we think we're smart. You know that kind of. You know, it's like one of them ones, and I was guilty, and I look back at that, and I cringe now. I just want to go back and slap myself in the face for being ignorant. But I agree with you. We don't need to know. We don't need to know what's happening here. We don't need to know about ratings, because wrestling's the only thing where, like, fans obsess over ratings. They don't do it for football, I don't think, or, you know, NFL or whatever. It's just wrestling. Wrestling fans just pick at it. It's like, it doesn't really matter, you know? It doesn't matter.
Really. Like the only other place that does it is, ironically, soap operas. EastEnders and Corey. I'm like, it's the same. Just enjoy it. Just watch it and enjoy it.
Isn't there like magazines that come out where they actually give you spoilers for the soap opera stuff, mm-hmm. that actually tell you what's going to happen? It's like, what? Don't get that at all. Just watch it and enjoy it. It's cool.
Exactly. Because we're working from home because of all this COVID stuff, I've been able to stay up for all the pay-per-views this year, which has been great. I've loved every second of it, even if it is trying to be on the Thunderdome. But it's like
make a point of watching stuff on, like, you know they put stuff up on YouTube and else, because sometimes I can't get to watch old shows, and I'll keep an eye out for Billy. Oh, there he is. Billy's kicking about again.
I'm so excited. Yeah. I got kicked out last time. I was so annoyed. but I got kicked out for booing Sasha Banks. Because yeah, I got kicked out for it. And I wasn't the only person to do it, to get booted for booing the good guy.
Wow.
I don't like Sasha Banks.
But you're so edgy.
I know, I'm so cool. Billy. But they were just like, oh, what do you think of Sasha? Well, I'm don't like Sasha particularly, so boo, and then I was gone.
And then they booted you.
So don't ask me a question where there's an open-ended answer here. Just tell me to cheer or boo. I will do both. I'll do either. Just tell me which one. Don't give me the option and then beat me for being wrong. Okay, so again, we're going to have so much fun. I can just tell I'm going to have so much fun in this podcast.
Tangent. We go off in tangents. Tangents are great. I love tangents.
So we'll try and get some, bullet points out of the way then. How did you start wrestling then? Where did you start?
It's funny. Being young and stupid, you know, backyard wrestling. Guilty, you know. There used to be a thing that I used to hide or be embarrassed about. It's like, I did it, you know, my friends did it. We were so into it that it's a part of my life. I'm not going to run from it anymore. You know, I've done some stupid stuff. I'm still paying for it now. One of them's a broken leg. And I'm still not right. Anyway, funnily enough, because of, I didn't say there was a backyard community that we were in, but there was, you know, it's the early rumblings of the internet, and, you know, people are putting stuff up. And actually, Johnny Lyons is another perpetrator who's guilty of the backyard wrestling, and that's how we first started talking. We started to communicate in 2005, maybe. Like, he might know the date better than me. But he was also doing it, and we just had like a common interest. Oh, you're doing it as well, and we're both a bit older, so it was like, oh, I don't feel so stupid that I'm still doing it because you're doing it as well. So we would communicate back and forth. You know, he was sending me DVDs of them jumping about like idiots, and we did the same thing. You know, it's like, and we did it. It's done. I'm not going to run from it. And didn't hear from him for a wee bit, and then he started training W3L. So I'm like, oh my God, that's amazing. You're actually doing it. That's fantastic. You know? So I was happy for him, not thinking that I would ever do it. Because to me, at that age, or just being so enamored with it, I just thought wrestling was a thing that other people did. It's like, not me. Well, I'm not going to do that because other people do that. You know, just like other people are actors and other people are in bands. Again, we'd love to be in a band. That's my second passion. Well, Ghostbusters and then music, whatever. and it wasn't good enough for music. I tried it. I'm gutted. I wish I was. Just couldn't get my head around it, but I still love it. So when he was doing it, I was, that's fantastic. That's brilliant you're doing it. And then he was like, out of the blue, he said, well, why don't you try it? And I'm like, you know, I don't know. So I ummed and ahed about it. But to me, like I said, it was more a thing of like, I couldn't do that. Because to me, it was too much of a, it'd be too difficult, or like it takes a special person to do it, which it does. You find out it does. But he kept that in me. And then I kind of just put it in the back of my mind and I left it. And then he ended up starting WrestleZone in Kirkcaldy. And he's like, look, I want you guys to come. Please try, at least try. And it's like, okay, well, now he's got his own thing. I can't really say no to him now because he's at me, like me and the guys. Like, and again, most the nucleus of WrestleZone now, I'm lucky that people that I've known for a long time, and in some cases, like I'm really super close to. So we have strength in numbers in terms of, okay, I may be panicking, I'm nervous, but at least I've got my guys with me, and maybe they felt the same way. We're all together. So we would, it was December 2007. We went down for the first time. Stu was there, run us for 5.5 hours because it was going to be a case of, because it's Aberdeen to Kirkcaldy, cramming everyone in the car there and back, it wasn't going to be like there 3 nights a week. You know, we just couldn't manage it. People had other stuff on. But when we were there, we wanted to maximize what we're doing. So we'd be there for 5.5 hours. And we love it. You know, actually finding out, oh, I'm actually capable of doing more than I thought I was. It's just, again, it's confidence thing. It's a self-esteem thing. I still struggle with it now a little bit, although I try and get rid of it whenever it pops up. So we would do it. Love it. Sit in the car like sardines, and now you're starting to cool off, and then you get the car when you get to Aberdeen and you can barely walk because, you know, it's a tough shift. But we're always talking about, okay, I want to go back, and what can we do next time? How can we make this better? How can we improve in this? So that would be that we would go down on a Sunday, long ass session, pay for it Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, feel normal again on Friday, repeat. And that's how we started. And Stu, Johnny, I guess, yeah, Johnny, Stu, I can't help it, sorry. Johnny Lyons, Stu, one of the best guys I've ever met, he gave us a start there. So I'll always appreciate that, you know. Like, he had a lot of confidence in us, more than I had in myself. I mean, he's always been a guy who's championed me, even when I was like, what do you mean? He's like, no, you can do this. I was like, okay. So he would give me a kick up the arse, you know.
So when I was doing my research for the website itself, I was going back and finding anything I could on WrestleZone when I was doing the title reigns and the history. So WrestleZone itself started in Kirkcaldy, as you said. Was about 2 years before it started coming up north, coming up this way?
Again, the time we got there, they'd been going for a few months at that point. I can't remember exactly the start. The first time they did a show in Aberdeen was June 2008 at Harlow Academy. So it was still based in Kirkcaldy, but myself and William Sterling and others were saying, look, you know, if you want to give Kirkcaldy, because, you know, when you run the same place a lot, you need to, it's good to give it a breather, because if you're there all the time, how can they miss you? You know, people have got their own philosophies on how to promote shows. I've got mine. Other guys have got their own way. If it works for them, brilliant. You know, everyone's got their own take and their own taste on how to do it. But for me, even if you're there all the time, then people get used to you. And then it's like going, maybe I'll get the next one. I'll skip this one. I'll go to the next one, whatever. So we were saying, look, if you want to do a show in Aberdeen, we're here. We will promote it for you. We will set it up. You just need to get the ring here, you know, the guys that are coming from Kirkcaldy, and we can start doing shows in Aberdeen. So our theory was that we could give 5 Kirkcaldy, Dunfermline, whatever, those places, a bit of a breather. So that happened. Did one in June, did one in November, and then we started looking at Summerhill Hotel and a Northern Hotel. And December 2009 was an Aberdeen show, but that was the first Aberdeen show where technically it was now Aberdeen based. So from about 2 years, so you're right, for the timeline, 2 years, yeah. Two years from when we started was when it kind of officially became, it's an Aberdeen based company. Yeah.
So those first ones at the Harlow Academy would have been the first Aberdeen Anarchies then, weren't they?
Yeah, technically, it's weird because they're not quite canon anymore. You know, it's kind of one of those things. Well, that was the old guard, that was the old era, and we kind of just. And I'm not dismissing that at all because I mean, you have to start somewhere. Like the early stuff, a lot of it's not good. It's bad, you know. And again, people like to go and come on these podcasts, and you know, and everything's positive, and that's great. But for me, being around a bit longer, it's like. If something isn't good, it's not good. But we couldn't have gotten to where we are without having these, because some of the shows were not good. You know? And there's reasons for that, which we might get into. But when you start, you know, and unless you're like an Angle or an Owen Hart or Dominic Mysterio, who came out of SummerSlam and just like, wow, you know, he looked amazing. You know, some guys can just come out to shoot and be fantastic. Some of the stuff, early stuff, was rough, and I'm not looking back at that unless I was having a few drinks with the boys and we can laugh at ourselves. I'm not watching that by myself. No,
I think there's absolutely a big
absolutely not. It's rough. It is rough. Yeah,
I think I got into Scottish wrestling at the perfect time because for me, I started in 2012. I started going watching.
Yeah, 2012 is a good year.
That was when I wasn't there for the bad years because 2012 onwards seems to be where everything was picking up and the bigger shows were happening. And of course, my first WrestleZone show was the following year, 2013, the first one at the Beach Ballroom. And from that point, I've only known WrestleZone as being the company that ran at the Beach Ballroom, and I've got these shows all over the country.
Yeah,
and so I think I went in the exact right point to see the best part of WrestleZone and beyond, thankfully.
But then even as same we say about the bad years, I mean, like, it's different as well because the way I'm looking at it is going to be different to the way, like, maybe, like, a regular might look at it, you know, because a lot of the people that were at those first shows are still coming now, so they must have enjoyed it. It's different because, I mean, you're going to be your own worst critic. I'm guilty of never being happy. The times that I have been happy, those matches are few and far between. Like there's a handful of matches that I was like, you know what, that was good. But like I said, you can't get better until you have some stinkers. And I've had plenty of stinkers. I've had plenty of them. Yeah.
So you're I would say considered as the franchise, the main guy, the Don Cena, as I called once, of WrestleZone. Just a segue, very briefly, epic, like so well, John Cena. So I got a fan question from Stevie, who actually did our third season of the OSW TV podcast when it was a thing.
I know Steve very well.
He asked, how good is John Cena and can you explain it under 5 minutes?
For me, wrestling's based upon creating human emotions, creating a feeling, not just that, you know, like a passive, oh, that was a good match. You know, wanting someone to win or wanting someone to lose to me is far more important than having a good match. And again, we get into a debate about what a good match is. A good match to me is a match that you're invested in. Are you invested in John Cena? Yes, that's why he's the man. Under 5 minutes. Boom!
We're saying
again, I could gush about Cena all day because I think Cena is storytelling, timing, presence, charisma. Yeah. And he looks fantastic. Tick, 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 tick. He sells merch. He has cracking matches.
I'm not what we were saying before hard. I hit record. It's the exact same thing for Randy Orton. He has all those things, and as you were saying, everything he does in a match means something. He does.
Like, to me, if you were, again, you speak about like if you were in a lab and you build a pro wrestler, you know, like Brock Lesnar's one of them, you know, Roman Reigns is one of them, like a Hogan's one of them, Warrior, you know, people that think, this is what a wrestler looks like. Now, Randy Orton isn't like a huge, massive giant, but he's tall, he's good size, he looks good, he's fluid. His facials, his timing, he makes everything look like he's not even trying. It's just, it comes to him. Like, Randy Orton is a guy that you would make in a lab. It's like, yeah, that's a pro wrestler. know, and those guys are few and far between, in my opinion. Yeah. He's special. He's, and I said to you before we start recording, he's my wrestler of the year. I mean, who else is there? And I know there's, I'm not a super big Japanese guy. I've watched some AEW, so I'm not dismissing stuff because, you know, I know enough to know what's going on, but I am a WWE guy. But to me, Randy Orton just ticks every box for me this year. He's just been incredible.
So absolutely. I would say Randy Orton, certainly, and probably the other one but off the top of my head, maybe just due to being a Scot myself, but Drew carrying the company during this time.
Watching that documentary that they put up recently is like, I like him even more.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's the one time I've actually put the network on in the living room, and 10 minutes in, my wife's went, wait, it's like 10 o'clock. I need to go to bed because I'm working early tomorrow. Can you stop this? Because I want to watch it. I want to watch it.
Because I picked a bad time to watch it because it was about 11 o'clock. I put it on. I said, why am I doing that? And, my girlfriend's son, he's 13, didn't have really any, like, he's came to some shows, but it wasn't really his thing. But he came through, he said, oh, what are you watching this? And then he sat there quiet for 20 minutes. And I said, right, time for bed. He's like, no, let's finish it. He's like, but you don't even know what's going on. He's like, yeah, but I like him. He's like, there you go. So, right. Like, he suits him as well. Yeah, so. Yeah, I'm really glad Drew's doing well because, he does deserve it because he's put his time in as well. He's had ups and downs, you know. Exactly. And I only had the chance to be around him the one time when he came in for the Nation show against Andy. But great guy, you know, so I'm happy for him.
I think it's a story I've said on the podcast before, but for some reason he follows my personal account on Twitter. I've no idea why, but he does. And the night after WrestleMania, I thought, you know what? I'll send him a wee personal message, a wee DM, because may as well. And so just thanked him. I really enjoyed it. I mean, the match itself was what it needed to be. Didn't have to be anything special. And then about 10 minutes later, this is the WWE champion, replied. I'm thinking, why are you replying to me? I'm just, but yeah, that's the kind of guy he is.
You know, like how much messages that he got during that time period as well, because it would have been you and thousands of others and his friends and family all saying the same thing. So, no, the fact that he took the time to reply to you says a lot about his character. So that's good to hear.
Absolutely. All right, we'll get back to you, though. This is what the podcast's about. How long was your entrance theme always Bad Religion, Sinister Rouge?
Yeah, it was actually. I don't even think there was any other real discussion. Like Dennis Law, a referee, is a bigger Bad Religion fan than I am. William Sterling's a big Bad Religion fan. I can't remember I don't think Dennis was around at that point, actually, but it might have been Sterling or one of the guys who said, look, you know, Rouge is red, it's Bad Religion, it's punky. And I mean, sometimes people will pick entrance music because they like it, but that's not a reason to pick it because sometimes it doesn't suit you. I mean, if a song was like disco and it suited me, I'd use it. You know, doesn't matter that I'm not into disco. But I was lucky that not only was one of my favorite bands, one of their songs, it fit me. You know, it's like I like it and also it works. So I lucked out there. It's been 12 years and I've never changed it. Mental, actually, you think about it. I've never really thought about that. It's been 12 years now, and I've never changed it. So
what I love about it...
I don't think I will now, unless there's a good reason to. Yeah.
What I love about it, the song's like 1 minute 48 seconds long, or something
it's
like that.
It's 1 minute 58 or something like that.
Something like that. And that is your entrance. That's exactly... From as soon as you get out of the through the curtain to as soon as you get into the ring, it's always that amount of time. And that's why I just think it's amazing. It's just like... That's it. Summed up. There you go.
And it was almost like I planned it. I didn't think that deeply. I promise I didn't. But no, for the purposes of this podcast, I meant it. But there's times that I know that I've been bumbling about outside the ring for too long when the music starts again because I know I'm going to get around when I go back. It's like just get in the ring. Sorry. So that's the guide. If I'm in the ring by the time it stops, then I know I'm doing good.
You've just about timed it. So your WrestleZone career, you've you've accomplished quite a bit from my research here. You've been No Limits champion. You were in the first, or you were in the unification match at Ardianica that unified the heavyweight championship with the No Limits championship. Mm-hmm. You've been tag team champion with Jay Lethal and Johnny Lyons, both of whom we'll probably speak about during this. And of course, you've been Undisputed WrestleZone champion twice. All right, I think that.
Yes.
Yeah, it was split up with Andy Wilde.
Yeah, there was some controversy there.
Yeah, but your first reign was 525 days, I think, wasn't it? Something like that.
It was like someone who's more organized than I am kept in. There might have been Martin Clunas, actually. Martin actually kept track of it because I'm useless for that. So, it's been this long. It was like, oh, wow, okay, well, that's a thing. I mean, there's a story there, you know, anything over a year now. And I know we don't run every week and we're not running shows every night. So it isn't as big a thing as, you know, like a WWE champion being that long. But still, over almost a year and a half is something to speak about, yeah?
And if again, I've written this down actually, but off the top of my head, I think you have one of the best win-loss records at Aberdeen Anarchy since the Beach Ballroom era, 2013. I think you only lost the once.
The guys that keep track of that, I think.
I'm one of those kind of people. Keep track of it.
I'm the total opposite. I think when you're in it as well, I'm like, you know, a lot of the guys are like this. I think it's like when something's done, you're looking at the next thing, and you're like, you never really stop. Apart from a lockdown, but you know, you keep going and keep going. So, but it's good that there's guys like you that actually keep track of it, because I don't, and I should, and I know I should. Yeah. I should have made a note of every match I've had. You know, the guys keep journals, and it's like, why was I not organized enough to do that? You know, I kicked myself for not being that guy. I'm just not that organized.
I would say trust cage match, but over the last couple of weeks, I've brought them up on podcasts, and folk have went, no, I didn't do that. So it's not a good way.
It's like, do you remember a guy called Stupendous?
Yes.
Brilliant name. Stupendous on cage match, I think Stupendous claims that's Blue Thunder. And yeah. Thunder's like, I can assure you I'm not Stupendous. It's like, yes, I know you're not.
But Blue Thunder's also credited to be the Bulgarian baker. I'm fairly certain he's a Sisto as well, which doesn't make sense, because I'm fairly certain they must have had a match at some point down the line where they'd been in the ring at the same time together.
Yes, it definitely has, yeah. So, cagematch.net.
Useless.
You said it, not me. But it's your podcast, so you can say that.
They're good for some things, but things like title histories as well. As soon as I put up stuff about the tag titles, I've had William Sterling go, "No, I've had an extra tag title reign. Thank you very much." So I'm like, okay, that's fine. I will try and find this.
He's had about five now, isn't he? Six.
I think he's
William up to five or six. Eight is it eight, man. That's wild.
I think it's seven on cage match, so I think it's eight now.
Because I mean, he had the run with Allen and then a run with Thunder, so he's one of the more prolific guys for tag teams. Him and Tucker, and Tucker Allen, and William, and Sean Johnson. Yeah. Anyway, sorry, tangent.
No, that's fine. Speaking about those Beach Ballroom shows at Army Anarchy, those guys. Particularly, I've done some wild things, especially evolving ladders and what have you. But your Beach Ballroom record, right? So, as I said, as far as I'm aware, off the top of my head, you've only lost once, and that was to Sean Johnson under controversial circumstances.
Yeah, I got big booted in the face
by Crusher Craig. Which was a beautiful callback to the year before, where you defeated Crusher. To retain, which was an interesting end to the show. For those unaware that are watching or listening to this, it was announced very quickly afterwards. I think most people in the crowd knew that Crusher injured himself coming off the top rope. What were your thoughts? Was there any thoughts going through your mind at that point, or was it just a case of this is how it's ending anyway, or just jumping in? What were your thoughts going
It's all a bit of a blur. him coming off the top is unusual, but he wanted to do it because, you know, it was like, well, someone out the box. I know coming off the top rope has now became normal, but for a Crusher Creator's character, it isn't normal. So again, there, the idea would be he's went to an uncomfortable place because he's had to go to that place to try and win the match. So that was what that was there for. Came off, I move out the way into Jackknife Bridge for the pin, 1, 2, 3. And as I'm on him, we get a 1, 2, and I think Dennis was in the ring for that one, I think. I might be wrong. But as a referee got to 2, I could hear him. Well, like, he's clearly not in a good place. He's not in a good way. By the time the 3 came down and I'm off him, then I know, right, something's wrong here. So I made a point of saying to the referee, look, he's going to need. So I need to get out of here because it can't be about me. So that's one of those things where normally you win the match and you would celebrate, but no, because that would just be the totally tone deaf and inappropriate and disrespectful to Crusher. So the only thing at that point was let the referee know. I came through and made a point of telling everyone help now. And we had the medical staff there because boredom show, you got, you know, obviously, you know, you need that anyway. But so they were in the ring with him, but I was in a blind flap telling everyone. And then I felt personally responsible for what happened. So I had a moment, I'll be honest, I did. It was Dodd Morrison, who take pictures for us back in the day. He was the one that topped me off a cliff, so to speak. Obviously, you know, I know, because I wasn't doing good. And obviously, Crusher was doing far worse than I was. But he sat me down and said, look, you know, it's not your fault kind of thing. You know, it wasn't like you pushed him up there. You know, it's one of those things that happens. And I think he came down, I moved, and as he's coming down, is like he said, instead of landing flat, he just, his foot came out and it jammed and he broke his hip. So obviously, I know me and Crusher had this big long feud in the past and everything else, but you know, when he was in the hospital, I made a point of going in regularly. A lot of guys did, you know. Aspen was in there a lot, I know that. I know, I'm sure Len was in. And again, look, all the guys that you would imagine were in there regularly. So he wasn't by himself very much. If anything, he played with some peace because he had a constant stream of people. And then some of the regulars were trying to find out where he was. And I thought that was a bit, So, no, the Crusher made a point of saying, no, these are the people that I'll be seeing. I'll be seeing the guys. I'll be seeing my girlfriend. I'll be seeing my family. And that'll be it. Because he had plenty of people coming in, you know. So yeah. I'm not saying who the regulars were, but he did say, it's like, I had so-and-so. I was like, oh, okay. Just, you know, again, give him his space. And I know it was out of love, but, you know, so we had a list of people that he was comfortable seeing, you know. Because, again, I don't think the fans need to see him in that position. You know, they want to see Crusher as Crusher, you know. You know, the monster, we don't want to see him laid up, and he didn't want them to see him laid up like that. It was rough.
The fan brain in me was even thinking that, because I don't know, it's totally probably absolutely by accident, but I seem to be able to find stories that probably hasn't been planned in WrestleZone shows. I don't know if you've read my reviews, but I seem to be able to link things back to stuff that happened 2 years ago. Nobody else will remember, but I've thought, oh, that's similar to that.
I've read all your reviews. Your writing's gone steadily. It's just getting better and better and better. I think it's all because you've kind of, you know, it's difficult to be negative, because you want to like everything, but you're starting to get good at calling it. And if something's not good, it's not good. If that's how you feel, then say, you know? It's okay to not enjoy something on one of our shows because we can't hit a home run every time. And yeah, I think you're getting good at being honest with that too as well.
I think I've also found it a bit more liberating that Adam does the analytical one. He does the what happened in the match, and I can just go around and go, right, go check out what happened in the match, but... so-and-so did this and so-and-so did that. And it's just like, yeah, I can get a bit more free to go, well, that was a bit rubbish, but this was good. So cool.
But you're right, because there definitely is callbacks, because that's almost a thank you to the people that have been there like regularly. I mean, as much as it is, it's for everyone, but there's things that are thrown in there to let people know. It's like, you know, this is for you and you'll get a kick out of this, and we do appreciate the fact that you're here all the time. So as much as, you know, the show is for everyone, there's little nuggets in there, like for yourself and some of the regulars, where they go, oh, all right. It's almost like being invested for this whole time. It's almost like a reward for us. Like, you know, we know you're here and this is for you, yeah. but not to the detriment of the rest of the show.
Yeah, so how I got to that was the main event 2 years prior was Crusher versus Jack Chester. Mm. And the ending was Crusher going to the top rope and Chester hitting him with the chair, giving him a tombstone, yeah. And that was it. So it was like, for me, it was like a redemption. If it all went well for him, it would have been like, yeah, his redemption arc and the one title. But yeah, if you go check out my reviews, I don't want to plug them too much, but the more recent ones, definitely lines like the Battle of the Nations, Nab Jarnicky, because Adam's done such a fine job doing what happened in the shows. I could just spend about 2,000-3,000 words just going, oh, this just reminds me of this, and this is amazing. The story has been 18 months in the making. This has been just everything. So yeah, it is a reward. It is a reward to go to these shows. I mean, unfortunately, I mean, Aberdeen doesn't seem that far away, but when you put up the cost and the time and all that kind of stuff, I can really get to like the bigger shows, or if you come to Keith, I'll go to Keith or stuff like that. So it's still rewarding, even if I'm only going to a couple of shows a year, that I'm still getting callbacks each time as well.
Yeah.
Especially around hotel shows. That's just, I don't know how you get the ring in there.
Oh.
And two, I don't know how...
We get the ring in, but with difficulty. Again, there's definitely a system of, you know, as I go up, you have to go down. And then as we come around here, we now have to both be at the same level. We need to pivot here, because you know when it starts damaging the doors or the walls or everything. And, you know, we had a couple of hairy moments. But it's such a good venue. I mean, like, we've had a couple of venues that are just not... What's the best? They're just not practical in terms of setup, but they're such good venues when the show starts, and you know, they've been good to us and they're well attended. And it's like, and the thing about Aberdeen as well is Aberdeen's a nightmare for venues. You know, either you've got your weird venues that are not worth it, or you get the venues that we use that are perfect, but a bit of a nightmare getting stuff in, or there's a leisure center in the ballroom that you can't justify all the time. So it's those kind of mid-level venues in Aberdeen don't really exist, and I don't know why. And which is why bands and acts tend to go to Glasgow, because there's better venues for them, and Aberdeen tends to be a bit of an afterthought.
Yeah, I mean, I went to some I think one show that wasn't yourselves in Aberdeen, there's one I went to the venue of, and not for the actual show itself, but I went to it for the Lita Q&A, which again, we'll probably speak about. And I saw it, and it was the week after it was supposed to be a wrestling show at it for a company no longer running. And there's so much glass. And I was in there going, why would you set up a show here?
We all had the same discussion. We had the same thought that you had there. We're going, you want to do a wrestling show, and taking stuff up here, taking up these stairs with all this glass is asking for an accident. I mean, doing the Lita night is easy. That's fine. You know, there's no ring going up. There's not a lot of gear coming up. But yeah, no, we thought the same thing. Is that there's a hell of a lot of glass in here, boys. Yeah, so yeah, we also thought the same thing.
But I think I remember when I first started getting to WrestleZone, I was getting annoyed about the amount of steps, but that's just because of my laziness. But there was like the beach ballroom, which I love the venue, but there were so many steps if you want to get anywhere in the place. And then the next show I went to that wasn't beach ballroom or Northern Hotel, which again, steps, was Fraserburgh. And it's like the tightest staircase I've ever been in. The second tightest being the Leisure Centre with the McFoley Q&A, which was just which was just a hallway of body odor and regret. but I got to meet Mick at the end of it, so it was all worth it. Just sitting there with my
Body odor and regret. It's the name of my difficult third album.
I took my then girlfriend, my wife, to go because she wanted to meet Mick Foley because he's the Christmas guy, is how I sold it to her. And that's fine. He had a Christmas t-shirt, Christmas shirt on, everything. But yeah, I was standing in that hallway. I don't think we'd get away with it now with COVID guidelines.
Everything. I mean, it's going to be a whole new world now. I mean, in the talking about COVID in general and shows coming back, that's a podcast in itself. Because I've got a lot of, and again, I've got a pinned tweet on Twitter. If anyone wants to have a look at it, but how I feel about it, because there's a lot of this romantic notion about, oh, we're going to get back to normal. Is it? Are we? I mean, we need to speak about the. What isn't a nice thing to talk about is, you know, it might not be the way it was for a long, long time. So we need to be prepared for that. No, that's just my opinion. That's another conversation.
Absolutely. I mean, I have written down the pinned post on Twitter because I thought that's a good talking point. But you pretty much say it all in the post. So if anyone wants to go check out, they should go do so.
Yeah, I think I do think it's important. Not because. It's me that said, I'm anything special in particular. I just think it needs to be addressed because the reality of the situation is, you know, no, we can't park a place anymore because we need to have people spaced out. Then from a business point of view, how is that going to work? Yeah. So I don't know. I hope it doesn't come to that, but it's possible.
Yeah, I mean, the only place I think it would not even kind of work, but you see these gigs at the moment that are going on, and you've got the kind of like cordoned off areas for families and that. I mean, that's an extra financial burden to sort that out, and then you're not going to get as much back in because not going to be that many people in, and they still have to pay people and rent the venue, and it's just, exactly. It's another podcast in itself where we could probably just spitball ideas and you go, nah, it's not going to work. because you're on that side of the fence, you're actually doing it. So I'm just here speaking about it.
But even there, but even being on this side of the fence, no, I mean, like, we don't have all the answers because there's no answers to hypothetical situations. No, we don't know what it's going to be like. All I can be is be realistic about it and be, look, though it'd be the glass is half full, but you know.
And along with that, last thing you need is a big speaking out movement to rock the boat also and make things more difficult. Oh no, wait, hang on, there was that as well. So it was
2020 has been wild, Billy.
It has been a difficult time. Oh, that's, I mean, I won't get into it because I won't put this one out for people to listen to, but that 2-3 weeks of that kicking off, I was working from home still, so it's fine, but I spent most of my time just delete, not my own tweets, but articles, delete. Oh, I've started, load up Twitter, delete.
it's been one thing after another. I mean, what a year.
Yeah, I mean, like I said to yourself, like you messaged me after I put out a tweet saying I've spent so long and I've deleted like 900 articles. And I was just like, honestly, if I heard anything about the guys up north happening, I think I would have just given up at that point because I would have just been like, what's the point? I'm not going to shows anymore. So I may as well just scrap this whole thing. So thankfully, nothing is happening. Thankfully, you're boring.
I'm boring. Well, I mean, look behind me. It's like, no, what do you, Scott? Well, I collect toys, for goodness sake. I'm not a danger to anyone. I'm not. I'm just, you know, and again, having stuff out with wrestling is super important. If wrestling's all you have, I think if wrestling's all you have, and not so much when it's, if it's what you do to feed yourself and it's what you do for a living, then that's different. But if it isn't, And if it's all you have, it causes problems. And I don't think it's healthy at all. You know, like unless it's your main source of income, you need to have a think. And it's caused a lot of issues. And it's caused people thinking that they're superstars and they're more than what they are. Like, let's just have a think. Let's settle down. and just look at what it actually is. Because there's levels to wrestling. You know, there's the guys in WWE, and there's AEW, and there's Japan, and there's Impact, and there's Ring of Honor. And a lot of times, then there's everything else. And even there, that's tiered, you know? So Scottish wrestling is great, but it is what it is. So let's not think we're more than what we are. And that's what's happened. You've got people who think they're more than what they are, thinking they can behave in a certain way and get away with it. I love wrestling, but you know what? It's not that important. It isn't.
Yeah. I mean, like you're saying, it's a niche of a niche of a niche. I mean, you've got your big American ones, Japan, and then you've got your European, and then you've got your British, then exactly. You've got your English, you've got Scottish. So yep. It's just...
I know, definitely. Again, I think some people, you know, we speak about people being in bubbles for COVID, you know, like you're in your bubble. Well, the wrestling bubble's a thing. And if you're stuck in your own bubble and you can't see out with it, again, that also causes issues. I mean, you need to be able to just go, you know, because wrestling, like, there's nothing normal about wrestling, but you need to be somewhat grounded and somewhat realistic to deal with it. And if you're neither of those things and you're in your own little bubble, then you can't see out of it. And for me, that's not healthy. And the thing about lockdown as well is I didn't think too much about wrestling, and I actually felt guilty initially about it, but I don't feel guilty now. Because it's coming up for 13 years now, and even when there was not shows happening, like the stuff happening, stuff being planned, blah, blah, blah. And it's been great, and I love it, but I don't love it the way I did. And I think that's more of an age thing as well. And I've done more than I ever thought I would. It doesn't mean to say that I don't love it. I had a lot of love for wrestling, so losing a little bit of it still means I love it a lot. But it's not the same as it was for me. And lockdowns made me put things in perspective. And then when all this speaking stuff came out, I'm just like, you know what? Like, really? Come on.
Exactly. I mean, you know? I think off the top of my head, I could probably think, like the layman, anyone, pretty much the rest of my family, they could probably only name one wrestler that's UK-based, that's active right now, and yeah. It's Bredo. But yeah. That's not because of wrestling.
Yeah.
So yeah. It's because of Scott Squad, and yeah. He's been able to expand his portfolio to mean wrestling. He could do wrestling, but that's not his life anymore. That's not his be-all
and end-all. And it's also because he's funny. And you don't need to be a wrestling fan to get funny. Funny is universal. And again, there's different, like people have different senses of humor, but funny or humor or comedy is far more broad and universal than wrestling. No, comedy is this and wrestling's that. I mean, like my mom and my grandmothers, God bless them, when we're still here, would have loved Grado. I mean, my mom would love Grado. I hear people came to the ballroom shows and left before my match because they didn't want to see me at the Kimsey Grado. That's cool. I don't mind. I get it. I don't mind. I'm just glad you came. They saw Grado and they went home. So cool. I know. Well, that's why Grado is here, because we want you to be there. I don't care that you didn't stay for my match because you were here to see Grado, and that's why he's in the show. You know? Funny or comedy stuff, I don't think you can have it drive, you know, like pull the train in a wrestling promotion, but I think it's important to have it, and Grado is like up there. And like I said, you don't need to be a wrestling fan to laugh at something, and that's why he always gets over. He always gets a reaction. It's people that don't like wrestling come to wrestling to see Grado. He's a draw.
It's a variety show at the end of the day as well.
Of course it is. It has to be. I don't want 7 matches of guys in black tights trading holds. Sorry, I just don't. You know, I want to see Alan Sterling, and I want to see Caleb, you know, and then I want to see Connor come out and fly about a wee bit, you know, and then I want to see Damien kick someone in the head, you know, and then I want to see Zag Dynamite give it a bit of this when he comes, you know, and we've got a good cast of characters.
Absolutely, and, yeah, that's the bit, again, that's what I love about WrestleZone. You've got story. Speaking of Grado, actually, he does Wrestling Daft, and I listen to that, and he has a lot of love for coming up to WrestleZone because of that. Because there's so many characters and the stories, and there's an interlinking story between each show as well. Alan Sterling, I don't think you can describe Alan Sterling in 5 minutes like you could John Cena.
Alan Sterling's my favourite Scottish wrestler, and I'm not joking. And it's not because I'm biased. No, he just is. Because he entertains me more than anyone else. So for me, he's my favourite. I keep telling him that. He thinks I'm joking. I'm not joking. You are my favourite wrestler. Probably Randy Orton, you're my favourite wrestler. Because he just cracks me up. It's like, he's just funny. He just makes me laugh.
He makes everything work.
Yeah, and also as well, Alan is more than capable of having a wrestling match too as well. And again, let's not forget that I know he's done a bunch of silly stuff, but he's done some wrestling there in between there as well. You know, Alan knows what he's doing pretty much with everything. And he's just a riot, you know? I think he's amazing. And I'm not biased. That's genuinely how I feel.
I will join you in that opinion because in my time of the last 7 years, I've seen Alan Sterling. I've seen him against Ross McTavish. So that's how I first saw him. I've been with yourself. You were teaming up with Ross. That was the first time I see him. So he was the bit of a clueless.
Sterling Oil, Alan.
Yeah, Sterling Oil. But at that point, it was a bit more of a hokey, clueless Sterling Oil.
A little Alan. Bit. We're getting there. Yeah,
yeah, but yeah. We'll yeah, dip it down. There. Then we've got Mixed Martial Alan, which is my favourite Alan iteration because I love the Jeff Jarrett. Jeff Jarrett, double MA.
Yeah, when he went in, yeah.
It was amazing. And then we got Serious Sterling. No, don't. We got Lord Alan Sterling.
Yeah, MMA, then it was Lord, yeah.
And then we got Serious Alan for Sterling. And then he's back to, he's now Captain Alan. So
if it's what he's best at. I mean, though he's playing a character, the way he is now. And the same with the lore stuff and the same with the Mixed Martial Alan stuff, that's more what he is. And obviously, he's embellishing it a lot, as you would. But when he was Serious Alan, it was fine, but it wasn't him. You know, for Alan to really flourish, you need to let Alan just do it. Don't tell him what to say. He knows. Just let him go. Just give him the freedom to just have it. You know, and he knows where the line is. And when it's time to do it, because I mean, that match, I know we're jumping about, but the match he had with Grado at last year's Anarchy, he leveled up there. Then the match he had with Joe Henry, he leveled up again. You know, so it isn't just him capering, he's having really good matches with, like, obviously Grado is like the king of comedy and Joe Henry is very good. So he's hanging with a couple of guys, you know, and he's more than hanging with them. I mean, he's with them. For me, he kind of leveled up with those matches in a big way, and I think it helped his confidence a lot too. You know, it's like, no, like, you can do this. Like, and like you say, Alan Sterling should be everywhere because he's great.
Yeah, he's absolutely fantastic. Whether he wants to believe it or not, he is, because he's just fantastic. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. But speaking of, like, leveling up, what I admire about wrestling, I'm mainly speaking about wrestling, not your own career here, but it's kind of all interlinked eventually. But speaking about, like, the leveling up, it's really amazing to see. I mean, you of course are one of the trainers at the WrestleZone Training Academy, so you'll get props at the same time for this. But seeing guys debut, and then, because I look at a couple shows a year, seeing them a couple months later and just seeing that evolution, just being in front of a crowd does to people. Because I thought it was being Nathan North being one. I saw one of his earlier matches. He was fine, very good. Did nothing wrong. And then when I saw him at Battle of Nations when he was in a tag match against Bingo Balance, he was another level of performer. And even guys that didn't make it all the way, Jimbo Bannum was a guy I was super harsh on when I first saw him, because I just did not enjoy what he did.
I remember reading that review. I was like, oh, you went in with both feet there, did you?
But then I saw him, Keith, a couple months later, and I was like, who's this guy? He wasn't the guy I saw last time.
I mean, having your debut match doesn't necessarily mean that, oh, no, obviously it didn't mean that you've made it. I mean, no, but you have in a way that you've done it, but you also keep your development when you're wrestling in front of people, because as much as you can learn running drills and everything, you can't replicate what you get in front of a crowd in a training environment. Like, if people that are with you acting as a crowd in a training environment, but they know you, they don't have, you know, they have more of a relationship to you than like average punter will. So you can't recreate that in a training environment. So you can have your first match and think you're ready, but working in front of a crowd becomes a skill that you need to develop on top of the physical. So what you've seen is you know, you've seen them debut and they're fundamentally fine. But on top of the fundamentals, you then need to learn, well, I need to remember there's people watching me. I need to let them come in and like be part of the story. And sometimes when it's your first match, you're just so nervous that you just forget. It's like, oh my God, I'm in front of a crowd. I just need to get through it. It's when you stop trying to get through it and you start owning it, is when you see the change of people. So physically, they could be doing the exact same thing, but they've taken ownership of what they're doing. And now they're telling the crowd, no, I'm taking you here. No, you're going to come here. As opposed to the crowd intimidating them and them almost kind of closing into a shell, is when people start, you know, the head down being in the corner versus head up, chest puffed out. And you know, oh, they've just taken that extra step there because they're now embracing the fact that, you know, especially if you're like a heel, it's like people can't see me. Or a babyface, like, yeah, we're in this together, or whatever, cheesy cornball. And I'm guilty of being cheesy and cornball, but hey, it's work. But yeah, no, you're right. It's like that change is coming from them being in front of a crowd again and again and again. And then it becomes normal, as opposed to, oh my God, they're looking at me. Because that's quite intimidating the first time. Oh my God, they're all looking at me. What do I do? You know, it's scary.
That's exactly. I was about to bring up the point you just did. It's you can see it from a wrestler who's nervous about, they've got their head down, they're concentrating on the match, but then as soon as you see them the next time and they've got their shoulders up and their heads up, you go, all right, this guy wants us to be involved now.
And you can tell the difference. You can totally tell the difference. Just taking that second to just let things breathe a little bit, and because it's difficult for a crowd to react to what you're doing if you don't give them the chance to react to it. If you're quickly moving on to the next thing, then that moment in time, that 1 second, is gone forever and you're never going to get it back. If you can just, and it's hard, and we're all guilty of still doing it. I mean, you get amped up, or you have an off night, and you go, why did I do that? Why didn't I just wait here? Why am I over here doing this when that should be more important? You know, even now, I mean, you're never going to stop learning. And the moment you stop learning stuff or start, you know, it's they just go, well, that's me, I'm done, see ya. Because you never will stop, ever. Never, ever.
So speaking of your, we'll try and swing back to your career then.
Tangent.
Yes. I'm very aware that Nova's kneeling walked. So I'm just trying to take off some bits off here.
I don't know if I can maybe coax someone else to take her out tonight. I don't know. We'll see what happens. We'll keep going.
I think I've ticked off quite a number of things here, but we'll go back to your wrestling career. So your first major title after the Beach Ballroom era began, I think that's when I started watching.
The Beach Ballroom era, I like that.
Yeah. You won the Tag Team Championships with Ring of Honor star, I think he was TNA star at the time, Jay Lethal.
Was he still on team?
Possibly. Might have just left. He was a Black Cheese.
And I know the first time I saw Lethal was a TNA pay-per-view and it opened up with him against Samoa Joe. Was that about Glory?
I remember TNA. It's not something I have.
It was 2005, because like TNA in 2005 was like brilliant. I loved TNA in that era. I thought it was fantastic, and then it kind of fell off a cliff a little bit. But that period there was great. But I was cool. That was a good night. I enjoyed that.
and you won the tag championships from teams, was it Team Smash at the time? No, Midas.
Smash, Superior Moves and Submission Holds. Shout out to James Midas, who I still occasionally throw sticks at and stones at on Twitter, but I love Midas. I miss Midas. You know, it's like, no, we had a disagreement. This is more a case, I saw something one way, he saw something another way. and he admits himself his heart was in it, and he's like, you know what, I think I'm done. I don't want to do this anymore. Which is fine. I don't know. Still love him. You know. But yeah, tangent.
And you played guitar using his title belt. I think that's.
I did. Yeah. No, me and Jay got the belts, but I don't know. I don't know why I did that. I don't know. I had Hogan's entrance with the Hollywood Hogan, and he would use his weightlifting belt. I don't know why that popped in my head, but it just did. So Jay's like, well, I'll do it as well then. So there's a great picture of me and him playing air guitar with the belts. I don't know why I did that. Again, music thing. It was like, you know, like, I'm a wannabe rock star, and I never will be. But yeah, no, that was pretty wild. Again, at that point, we'd had Colt Cabana in. We'd had Duggan and Billy Gunn at the first Anarchy in the ballroom. But that was the first time I'd worked with someone that, like I'd watch as a fan, because like 2005 I wasn't in yet, like 3 years before I got in. So I'm sitting watching that TNA pay-per-view, not knowing who Jay Lethal was, and think, God, I like him, because him and Joe had a cracking little match to open the show. And then fast forward 8 years later, we're winning the tag battles together, and it's like, life's weird, you know. And I think as well during the lockdown, it's like because wrestling just stopped. Is that having a wee think back, and it's like I've had a chance to do some pretty cool things, stuff that again goes back to what I said. Like other people do wrestling, I don't do wrestling. That's for other people. And now you know, and it was never going to go anywhere. But it was one of those things. You know what? Like people aren't going to expect this to happen. So let's just give him a moment. You know, I mean, and whether that's, and again, people can pick at that logic completely and give me a reason why to not do it, and I totally agree with them. But it felt right. It just felt, you know what? People got a kick out of this, you know. So, and they did. The place blew. The place popped big. And I know, like, you don't do it for pops during a match, in my opinion. But you know, obviously, your finish should be, like, if it's done right, should be the biggest reaction in the match. And it was, because people are, oh my God, it's actually happened. And we couldn't do anything with it, because, you know, he was. Was he Ring of Honor champion? No, he wasn't.
My Ring of Honor history is not that great.
No, he was a champion in New Japan. That's what it was. He was a champion in New Japan, and he was mega busy with other stuff, and it was a case of he just couldn't commit to it. And we knew that. It was just, wouldn't it be, what if we give people a great moment? Because sometimes it's not wrong just giving people a great moment. You know?
Yeah. And I absolutely agree with that. I think at the time, I was getting messages because I just started all this OSWTV stuff, and I was getting messages from folk going, oh, what do you think of this? This is short-sighted, short-term. I was like, it's wrestling. I'm still paying to go, so I don't.
And it's also, as well, it's not like we have TV the next night, like it's the pay-per-view, then it's Raw. We don't have that. It's like, I mean, we're in a position to create moments like that because it isn't as important for everything to make sense. And we do stuff that makes sense all the time. Why can't we just have, you know, wouldn't this be a cool moment? You know, and people were jumping, you know, and I don't regret it at all. It's always going to be a thing that I'm going to look back at. A thing that sticks out was two things with Lethal that stick out. One, he was more excited than we were. He was just giddy. Because he just wants to wrestle. And before we went out, he was just, I just say, are you okay? He's like, I'm ready to go, brother. And he was hyper. And it's like, okay. He's all these ideas and stuff. And I'm like, I don't think I can do all this. I talk him off a cliff a little bit. Because he was in go mode, you know. Like, I mean, this is what he does for a living. You know, he's been working in Japan. It's like in the tag matches I had with Sabin and Shelley and all this stuff. I was like, I don't know if I can do this. I was like, that's not who I am. It's like, I mean, there's things I do well, but I've got a lot of limitations, and you know, that's just the way it is. I know what I can do. I know what I'm not good at. But we got through it. There's a couple of moments where I was like, I could have done that better, but that's just the way I am. But he was excited, and afterwards, obviously people would get a picture with Lethal. So standard, you know, after, you know. So, and people are paying to get a picture of Billy Thornley. He's a star, and it's cool. But so I said to him, look, you know, people are here to see you. So off he goes. Like, no, we're the champions. So they get pictures with us both. And it's like, okay, cool. So yeah, pictures, everything, blah, blah, blah. And then he's made some money off it. And then he gave me half the money. And it's like, you don't need to do that because this is what you do. This is what you do to, you know, to pay your bills. Like, no, they pay pictures to see the champs. You're a champ, you get half. And it's like, man, yeah. You know, I mean, how can you?
Yeah, you can't. You know, I mean, I've heard he's one of the nicest guys ever. I mean, like, I met him very briefly at an Inverness show. Unfortunately, I was working. I was transporting Rob Terry in a tiny Clio. And
I forgot that you were the driver for a wee bit, weren't you? Yeah,
I was. Good. Yes, yeah, I transported Rob Terry, and I think we had to replace the car shortly afterwards. And my wife has blamed Rob Terry ever since.
He's a big lad, though, isn't he?
He's humongous.
Yeah, he's a big guy.
Yeah, I had to pick up from Inverness Airport, but yeah, I mean, I got there, but I thought I wasn't in the line because I was working. I should get a picture. No, I should. But I was hoping just to get a picture with him because I didn't take any money with me. I was just driver. And he was like, oh, sorry, it's £5. I was like, all right.
Really?
Cool. And that was it. But I think it's just because I was near the queue. I didn't bring him up again. But I'm not saying that to slight him. He was very nice. He was very polite about it. But he was just like, it comes with a picture. It's £5. Like that. Okay, cool. I'll just leave it then. And then just walked off. But yeah, so again, not a slight on Jay Lethal. He's very nice. He's very polite about it. Same with Davey Richards. He wouldn't get a picture with me because I didn't buy anything. But again, he was very nice about it. I wasn't offended at all. So in the beautiful storytelling that I've made up in my head, from that point, the tag titles were vacated. Which meant that management set up a tournament, and which led to a makeshift tag team that became known as Thunder Buddies.
Yeah.
So, in a roundabout way, it's your fault that Thunder Buddies were created, that they came back, and then they took titles off you. So, how that's a big circle go around. But when other tag team title reign was the beautiful pairing of yourself and Johnny Lyons.
That's one of my favorite things I've done.
The team that wasn't a team, Johnny, according to yourself, but
I loved. I really got a, again. It's like serious wrestling's got its place, but I also think there's a place for Gaga. You say about sports entertainment, I don't think we should forget the part that says entertainment. And I knew it'd be a riot. And I had so much stuff I wanted to do, but just with Johnny not being local, it was hard. It was hard to line up. And that's a big regret. I'm not going to say what they are, because one day I may get to actually use them in another capacity, so I'll save it. But, I was a lot. Also, because, I mean, I wouldn't be doing this without him giving me a kick up the arse and, come on, you can do it. Give it a go. So there's a lot of truth to what was going on there. I mean, like, me and him were really close. Still are. I know that don't see him too much. That's wrestling. I mean, I won't see him for a year. Then I'll see him again. It'll be like, you know, it'll be, so there's a lot of that was genuine. And the way he is, like, something, he'll say something that's really embarrassing and cringy. It's like your uncle at a wedding. It's like, oh, Johnny. You know, it's like the way I'm reacting to him is actually the way, it's like, there wasn't a lot put on there. It's like, that is genuinely the way we have been together in the past, just like sitting talking, and he'll come up with something. He's like, I can't believe you just said that, what are you doing? So, oh, shut up. You know, like, and no, like, it's not out of hate, it's out of love, because totally out of love. So I think that's why it worked, because there was like a genuine thread of something real. And that's the best stuff, because if you can inject something that's real into it, people are going to know you're not putting it on. People aren't going to see through it. They're going to know that you're being genuine with it. Whether it's amped up to 11, there's going to be this thread of something that's real. And that's when wrestling's best. So it's fair about having a good match. Is it, what's a good match? You know, I want people to be invested in what's happening. I want them to care about the people involved, because when they care about the people involved, that's when wins and losses become important. You know what I mean? It has to be that investment. And also because me and Johnny have been around since the start, helped. Because they had this built-in loyalty. But even when Johnny wasn't a particularly nice guy to people, it's like they still respected him. So, I mean, you can tell those stories with people that have been around for a long time. You have to have that built-in kind of the built-in trust. And then you can start doing stuff like that. You can't do that with like a bunch of new people. You need to do it with people that be around a little bit. You know what I mean? It's like it has to be that kind of built-in. And I hate to say legacy because it's such a pretentious thing to say. But you know what I mean? It's like there's something. There's years before it. You know.
Absolutely, and that led to, of course, his final match being in WrestleZone in the match that led to Thunder Buddies regaining the titles. So it was, and he got a stand ovation, and it must have been very bittersweet because you were in the ring with Johnny. Of course, he got you started, and then William Starling as well would have been round about the same time as yourself. I'm assuming he's one in the car, and Blue Thunder must have been round about then as well. Yeah. So
it was a little bit later, but him and Tucker and Sean were a little bit later, but generally that time period,
I said in this podcast in previous ones, because I've had a lot of FPWA guys on, that Johnny Lyons is just he's I think he's one of a kind. Because it doesn't matter when you do the Union Square shows, when that was a thing, I would end up coming up to them just on the train or that. And as soon as I saw it was a Johnny Lyons match, he would jump out the ring and just go, "Billy Strachan! Hey, Johnny." Just in front of everyone, all these strangers, and just shouting my name at me and going,
yeah, he even put it. It's like, no, that's just the way he is, and it's like a cliche. It doesn't matter whether there's 10 people or 1,000 people, he gets the same match. But he did though, even to the point where I'm saying to him, maybe not do the leg drop off the top tonight because you're a bit sore, or no, be fine. It's like, but you just told me that you're sore from a previous match, so maybe not do the top rope leg drop, or it'll be fine. He just told me that fine. There's no point. It's like, okay, whatever. And then I'd be there, drops a leg, comes back through. It's like, I'll really hurt myself there. I told you not to drop the leg off the top.
Oh, yeah, you can't have a Johnny Lyons match without having the best leg drop ever.
Amazing. But it's just, he's like, he had to. I think he felt he was cheating people if he didn't do it. It's like, some people don't know it's a thing you do. Don't worry about it. But he would go and do it, and then he'd pay for it. But he just loved it, man. I mean, when he said he was retiring, because he said it before, he said it more than once. So I'm like, yeah, okay, whatever. And then he's like, no, I actually mean it this time. And he's like, oh, God, you're serious. But I was still waiting for that got you. Mm-hmm. That maybe a little bit, is he being serious? But he's been on about that for quite a while. But it seems to, obviously right now there's no wrestling shows anyway, but I mean, I think he'll get, I can't see him not doing another one. Johnny, he'll drop the leg one more time.
I would not be shocked if Andy tempts him out for something with Fife Pro Wrestling Asylum.
I don't know. I don't think Andy would put him in that position. I think it'd be Johnny would be pestering Andy.
And Andy's okay, like, yeah.
Are you sure? I don't think Andy would do that to him. I think it'd be the other way around, and Johnny would be like, how about this? He's like, well, I thought you retired. Yeah, but how about this? And I don't know. I am surprised that he's stuck to his word so far. But obviously he's helping out with the youth group, with their academy. So he's still getting to be a part of it. Because him not being a part of it, because he's put too much time in, he's got too much knowledge, and he's liked and respected by almost everyone. So it'd be stupid for him to not still be involved in some capacity, because it would be a waste. No, especially now in light of, you know, so much people being outed, and again, not get into that again, but you know, we kind of need people like him. You know what I mean? No, we need people like him still around, because I know a lot of people are just aren't good for it or can't be trusted. So,
So on a bit more happier note, we're speaking about the special guest.
Sorry, I took it right down.
I was just thinking. We're speaking about especially the guests and Jay Lethal and what have you. The year was it 2015 or was it 2014? Anyway, you teamed up with X-Pac.
Yeah, 2014 at the ballroom.
2014, yeah. That was with you, Mr. P, and it was against. It was a revolution. It was called. I'm sure it was Revolution.
It was Revolution. Archer, Damien, and Johnny. Yeah.
So, I think I've heard Johnny speak about the match a little bit on Stephen Louch's podcast, Tuck of the Draw.
Yeah, I listened to that one. Yeah.
What was your thoughts going in teaming with X-Pac, who's of course. He would have been what we'd be 1-2-3 kid when you were kind of getting into it. So you've seen his evolution to X-Pac.
Yeah, when he had the match with Razor and he beat him on Raw. So from that point to I've watched everything he did that was televised on pay-per-view or TV, whatever. When I was 12 years old, I had a big X-Pac poster on my wall. I can remember which wall it was. I can see it in my head, and I remember told my mom about it, and it's like, remember 1-2-3 kid? It's like, oh yeah, because she always said that he looked like my cousin Gary, and he did, which is funny. So it's like, yeah. We've got a show on Saturday. And it's like, oh yeah, I'm teaming with X-Pac. The 1-2-3 kid. It's like, no, you're not. It's like, I am. It's, no, you had him on your wall, and it's like, I know I did. And it's like, that's ridiculous, that. But I think she was proud, but she was like, no, you're not. It's like, well, I am. So, yeah, that was pretty wild. He's also a character. It's like, he's had a paper round. He's had a hard paper round, but he's still here. He's one of the, you used to hear the stories about Eddie Guerrero, where, like, beforehand, he'd be a bit, you know, like getting a bit was a bit difficult and he was feeling it, but then when the light came on, it would just be, he was fine. So that was X-Pac. At the moment he came through the curtain, he was like on, because before that, was it the day he made it to Aberdeen? And I was with him at one point when he came in, and he just mentioned offhand about, you guys got any, energy drink? And I was like, yeah, just feel any pick up. Yeah, we'll pick you something up and then we'll meet you later on. So find him, whatever it was, Lucas Ed or whatever, energy drink. But I get it to him. And then he looks at me like I've got two heads. And he's almost offended, as if me giving him that is me trying to tell him that you need to switch on a bit. So he'd obviously totally forgotten that he just asked me to get this. He'd obviously went for a wee sleep and then woken up again, completely forgotten our conversation. And now I've got heat wags back because he thinks I'm disrespecting him. He's like, no, you asked me to do it. It's like, he doesn't remember. It doesn't matter, Scott, just leave it. It doesn't matter. Don't pick your hill to die on. It's just, you know, he was a little bit, but then when it came time, I mean, I say this, but like, he's a lovely guy. He was a really, really good guy. He just needed to just keep an eye on him, you know. And but when it was time for the match, he was fine. He drove over the ring onto Johnny and did a spin kick. He did the Bronco. He did the X Factor. He did all the stuff that people. He did the greatest hits. People came to see the greatest hits. You know, and like, as long as he does that one, people are gonna leave happy. The match went a touch too long, and that was my fault. And I could hear X-Pac on the apron getting annoyed about it. It's like, oh my God.
Strike two.
It's like, strike two. But then, again, he immediately forgot about it, so it was fine. I could have shaved a minute off that, and that's my fault. The reason for that was he was having such a good time. I mean, the one thing I can do is there's not a lot of things in it that wrestling that I'm great at. I think I'm competent in some things. I think the one thing I am great at is taking a hiding. And I was taking a hiding from the three of them, and I was having too much fun. And it was time to get out. And I knew it because I could hear Pac shouting. So get out of there. It was like, oh God. Oh no. But yeah, no, I loved that match. That's a match I could go back and still be happy with. And yeah, it's all fun stuff to pick at. I know X-Pac had a good time. Everyone took care of him. He obviously was up for it because he did some stuff that he didn't need to do, but he did. Yeah, I was really good. I did enjoy that. And everything Johnny said with Stephen is pretty much spot on, yeah. I listened to the podcast going, yep, that's right. And he kicked him between the legs by accident. Yep, that happened too, right at the start. Between the legs, oh my God, he's just not shot at them. That's good. The match has just started and he's kicked him in the, oh God. But yeah, no, it was good. I really enjoyed it. And everyone was happy with it. And the place was pretty damn loud. And that's good. I know, and that's a good feeling when people are reacting to it, because if people are sitting on their hands, then like, and again, it's easy to get annoyed at a crowd for sitting on their hands, but it's not their fault; it's your fault, you know, because they don't like what you're giving them. So give them something that they want. So, but anyway, yeah, that was a good night.
So, again, I don't want to inflate your ego too much, or WrestleZone's general ego. But what I love about the Aberdeen Anarchy ones especially is you always get the guests in at least a day or two beforehand, and they do all the radio interviews and local radio, do your signing meet and greets in other places. When the committee or yourself and everyone are putting together the Aberdeen Anarchy shows, is that something very conscious? Is it just last minute promotion? Are you very conscious of like, let's get a guy in the day before and we can get some sound? Or
I make no bones about it. We are very influenced by WWE because the way they do things, they're making things feel special. Taking an event, obviously WrestleMania is a big one now, and they do like a whole week of stuff sometimes. But taking an event and putting stuff around it makes it feel more important. It's a perception thing as well, because you're telling people, oh, maybe you haven't been to the other shows, but you should probably come to this one. And if you're still on the fence, maybe you would have come to this beforehand. Yeah, maybe that'll get you interested. Because I mean, basically, Anarchy is our WrestleMania. And for me now, the WrestleMania is more than just the actual show. There's everything that goes to it. And obviously, we're a far smaller operation. And we can't emulate what they do, but we can take from it and try to implement it on our own scale and make it work. So it's just, it also builds a bit of anticipation, you know, the show's coming, the show's tomorrow, you know. So again, the amount that we do can often depend on, well, is how willing is the person to actually do more than just the show? Because some guys just want to do the show and go away again, which is fine, you know. But that was a period where, again, people speak about wrestling being up and down or whatever, but that was a period where things were going pretty strong for us and we were in a position to do it. Now, I don't know if we're going to see those days again, you know, which is disappointing. So it's nice to talk to you and actually in reminisce, because I don't know if we'll get back to that. But I'm glad that we had it, yeah.
Yeah, I'll happily reminisce about WrestleZone. Like I said, last 7 years they've really been the anchor of my Scottish wrestling passion, mainly because, not mainly, but it's the closest promotion that regularly runs near me, but also always helps. But the shows itself, I never leave disappointed, even if there is a match or two that I'm thinking, I could have been something different, could have been another thing. But as long as I leave,
not always at home run, you know what I mean? Yeah. And I think, again, it's another, I mean, there's so much in my brain now, that because I haven't really, this is the most I've sat and spoke about wrestling since for a lockdown, so now my brain's going, so it's your fault for all these tangents. But you know, I don't think every match should try and hit it out of the park, because then the matches that hit it out of the park become normal, and it shouldn't be normal. And other people think that everyone should go out and try and steal the show. Don't agree with that. because I think it's disrespectful to the guys that maybe need to steal the show. And it's guys who are far better than I ever will be, who have that opinion, and they'll explain why. And I was like, you know what, that's a really good explanation, but it's also okay for me to look at it from a different point of view. And someone will say, well, you're not wrong, but I think, again, this is what happens when everyone tries to steal the show. By the time you get to the main event's like, well, now what do we do? Because we've seen everything. And I think your main event should be sacred. But that's a very, again, it's a very WWE thing. It's a very Memphis wrestling thing. I mean, I'm a bit older, so I'm influenced by things that maybe seem old-fashioned and passé now, but that's just what I believe in. I think a show should organically build. I don't think it should constantly be trying to, because once you get to here, there's nowhere else to go but down to come back up again. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So again, sometimes when you see some matches, and again, I think there's a place for a match to just be a match as well. But then it's with the whole variety show thing, you might like that Lion Tamer, but you might not like the four clowns coming out of the car. But then you might like something later on. So it's cool, you know? Sorry, tangent.
No, I'm absolutely in agreement with that. I not to build a perfect show, but in my mind, you have really hot, if say six matches, really hot starter one. Maybe the second match dips a little bit just to kind of settle you in, and then the main event first half is going to be good, but just to tease you into the second half, and then you can kind of build it up and go all out for the main event, and that's how I find. That's how I enjoy shows. I like to have hot starter,
yeah, I agree with that.
Little settle, a little bit going, right, I've seen the first match, let's just settle down a bit and watch the rest, and then you go balls out for the second half and just get people to come back.
But again, I mean, that's another podcast, the whole principles and psychology behind different ways of putting a show together, and every one of them could be right. But you can have one way of doing something, but is it right for your audience? And that's another thing you have to take into account. It's like doing something a certain way might be right for an audience over here, but you try and take the same thing and do it for the audience over here, and then they sit in their hands because they're not educated to it. Then you need to think, well, what does the crowd want? And you only get to the point by failing and failing and failing. And then, like you said, we could do what we do and we could go somewhere else with it. And they're just like, well, they don't like it because it's not what they're educated to. So it's so layered and it's so complicated. That's why we're quite lucky to have what we have, because we know what they want, you know, and we could go somewhere else and we could struggle, but we know what they want and it's our job to give it to them. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you've got your core fan base, the ones that'll be, more often than not, if I'm coming through to a northern hotel show, I'll see them queuing up at 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock to come in for.
Yeah, they're there before we are.
Kid. Yeah, I mean, I can't believe it sometimes, because I drive through because the tradition is if I'm dragging Kelly to wrestling, which she loves anyway, but she'll just go for a rumble. She loves a rumble. But the caveat is we got to go to Pizza Hut. That's the rules. So we'd have to we go to the beach, Pizza Hut, and then go to the show. And we'll come in at about 1 o'clock. Yeah, there'll be people just sitting outside. I'm going, you're going to be at the show tonight because I recognise all of you. So
yeah,
it's dedication at its finest.
I mean, it's wild because I mean, like, those guys are going to get a good seat regardless. You know, but hey, you know, I appreciate it. You know, but I mean, I wouldn't go to a gig and queue up at 1 o'clock for a gig at 7, but again, you know, everyone's different.
Yeah, absolutely. And they want to get their pictures and everything. I'm sure they've got several pictures, probably the same pose, same venue, but you know, that's what they do. That's just what they do. And if I could, I probably would do it too, but yeah, I'm the same. I don't want to, but like, I'm like, if there's a big show going up, like Avenue Anarchy once, I've kind of got a bit more grown up now. I'm thinking, right, I've timed it a little bit better. The first year I went was the 2013 one. I came through on the train super early. And then
I think I remember this, yeah.
And I didn't know Aberdeen well at all, even though I've lived like 50 miles away from it for years. So I didn't know like the beach was that close. I didn't know that if I walked 20 minutes, I'd be in town. So I just went to the gym next door to the beach ballroom and had lunch and read Hacksaw Jim Duggan's book. That was about my whole time waiting before Aberdeen Anarchy. But yeah, it's like I say, I've learned a little bit what to do and where to go, but yeah, it's been an experience. But speaking of guests, there's another guest that you've interacted with in Wrestler's Own history, of course being Mick Foley, who we spoke about a little bit earlier on. Of course, you got to dish out Christmas presents with Mick, which unfortunately means that was the last of the Scotty Swift shirts, so I'm unable to get a hold of one. So I've never been able to
get one. I need to get some t-shirts done so you can get one, and then I'll just stop producing.
just one.
I'll just do the one. Oh no, a very limited run of one of one for Billy.
Oh no, so if you do one of one, someone else will get it for you. I'll take it. That was a wild event. I still remember. I honestly think I've never asked him, but I think Adam got half of the table. It was raffled off.
Okay. All right. Okay. Got you. Yeah.
Yeah. Because I saw the table getting raffled and I thought, I'm not taking that home if I win. That's huge. I don't know where I'm going to put it.
Yeah.
And I saw the person who won it. I said, I'm sure it was Adam. And I could just see his face looking at it going, oh no, I've got to take this home.
Yeah.
No,
I've got to get this home.
Like the excitement's there.
A really unique raffle prize, but you also need to think, should I be entering this raffle? Because I now have to lug this thing home. Especially imagine taking that in the bus or something ridiculous. I've got a handful of wrestling heroes. One of them is Bret Hart, without a doubt. It's like probably in now with my taste changing, I actually think Bret Hart is my favorite of all time now. I've just got a better appreciation, and just the world's changed, and I look back at stuff now. You know when you look back at stuff and it's almost like the rose tinted glasses. With Bret Hart, it's just like, you know what, he was my favorite, but Mick Foley's in the conversation as well. So, and Mick Foley had a reputation hearing stories from other indie promoters that he was hard to deal with, and he was an absolute gentleman. So, and he actually, I'm not going to get into the details of it, but actually shared a story. It was actually a show that we were at as fans, and all the stories about, oh, Mick Foley was rude to me, and Mick Foley was this. It turns out that the guy he was working for stiffed him on a bunch of stuff, and just basically mistreated him and didn't give him stuff that was promised, which put him in a bad mood, because it would, and that's why he was that way. And I think the moment he came in for us, he twigged, no, these guys are cool. And he was fine. And you see on his show, he did the promo, which we thought, well, great, we got a promo. And Mick Foley is one of the greatest promo guys of all time, so you have to have him do something. Obviously, he's not going to do a match, but we know that, so that's fine. But then he wanted to hit this guy, he wanted to hit that guy, he wanted to put the soccer on someone. And he's like, cool, yeah, okay. Because we thought, obviously, with his limited physical capabilities, you know, because he's got a lot of injuries from some of the wild things he's done, we figured that, you know, we'll get him talking, we'll get him at ringside for the match, and that'll be great. And he wanted to do all this and all that. So I was like, wow. So obviously, he wanted to do more, which means he was obviously comfortable with what we were doing. And all the stories that we heard about him being hard to deal with were simply because the promoters didn't do their job, which is, it starts with the promoter, and then, you know. So he came to me during the show. I think the show started maybe, and he said, oh, would you mind doing a thing at the end of the match where you can bring out Santa for me? So I've got my heroes asking me if I would be okay, you know, like setting this up for him. And in my head, I'm going, oh my God, oh my God. And again, this whole thing about, oh, you're not meant to market when you're involved, nonsense, right? Mick Foley's in front of me. I love him. He's a hero of mine. I had one wall in my bedroom. One wall was dedicated to Mick Foley. It was all his stuff. I bought cheap socks and wrote stuff in it and I tacked them on the wall. Like, I loved him. Like, he was my hero. So he's in front of me asking me, oh no, so polite, asking as if him asking me is somehow going to be an inconvenience to me. So in my head, I'm going mental, but I need to be professional. So I said, yeah, no, we can work something out. I'll definitely see you out there. That's cool. And then I walk away. I'm going, oh my god, you know, and I know that's not cool. You know, I don't care. I'm not cool. Look at all the stuff behind me. I'm not cool. I don't want to be cool. I love it, right? You know, and that's another thing that has to stop as well, is if people making you feel like you're less than for being excited about something. Screw that. I'm excited about a bunch of stuff, and I'm an adult, but I'm never going to grow up because growing up sucks. Okay. If you love something, then love it, embrace it. So I'm in the ring with Mick Foley and I get the microphone and blah, blah, blah. And I'm thinking, this is great. So I'm in the ring with Mick Foley. What? How's this happening? So bunch of pictures, make sure people take a bunch of pictures. So I've got a bunch of pictures with me and Foley in the ring. And again, like me as well, and the Mr. P and Kenny Garrick in the ring with Mick Foley. Great. You know, it's just, you know, we are a professional. I think we're good at what we do. Allow me this opportunity to be excited. I mean, William Sterling got the Socko, and he's got a framed picture on his wall. Maybe I shouldn't have told you that, but he doesn't care. He's got a framed picture on his wall because Mick Foley was one of his heroes.
Well, someone said, I heard on a podcast once, I can't remember who said it, but I don't like the word marks, but for the sake of this quote, it works. The biggest marks in wrestling are wrestlers because they loved it enough to become wrestlers.
Correct.
So,
correct.
I am not offended at all. I mean, as a fan, I'm not like going, oh, he took a picture with someone that was on the show. Oh, what a mark. It's like, I would do the same. I tried to. Jay Lethal tried to charge me £5 for it. But I was like, I was exactly the same. So when I was doing those runs, I met Drew. Maybe this is why I followed him on Twitter. But I was security for Drew for a signing, which, you know, I think he can handle himself, but anyway, I was security, and after everyone had left, I went, do you mind if I got a picture with you? He went, yeah. So, why wouldn't you ask Mick Foley for a picture? Why wouldn't you ask even Tyler Bate when he was up, and he was the first WWE UK champion? Of course you're going to get a picture with him.
Yeah.
Regardless if you're on the show.
I mean, for that show, we had Dodd in for photos there as well. And Mick was backstage saying, oh, sitting there. No, I don't know if you said to Don, but basically Don had his camera and Mick saying, if you want a picture with Mick, just come through now. So we're all like, yeah. So there's a cracking picture of me and my gear is sitting next to Mick, that I think is on my fan page on Facebook. I'm sure it is. And it's just like, this is, you know, and you can just tell I'm delighted. You know, Mick Foley, you know, And if that makes me a mark and a bad person, then I'm a mark and a bad person because I don't care. Because never forget why you're doing this. Like, why am I doing it in the first place? It's for people like him. Now, I don't emulate what he did because I would pass away immediately of the stuff he did, but he influenced me in a way, doing the same way that Bret Hart did and Hulk Hogan did and Randy Savage did. You know, and it's like, oh, look at these guys. And Mick Foley played in a bigger way because he proved that it's like no, you don't need to look like a Hogan or a Warrior to do this. You just need to have something about you. The whole mark thing is like, you know, it's almost like being a wrestler and loving other wrestlers is somehow wrong, which is just ridiculous. It's just ridiculous.
You wouldn't get it in football, would you? I mean, if you're a football player and you played against,
I don't know.
Juventus, I mean, you see Ronaldo.
Maybe, I don't know. Yeah. You know, like a world famous. I mean, I'm not a football guy, so my knowledge is
poor. Well, hang on. I think you find on Twitter, I'm being told that you're the biggest football fan ever.
that is an elaborate wheeze. The gimmick is Thunder asking me football questions. So what do you think of that? and me just bluffing an answer. It's like, I don't know what you said. So the ongoing gimmick with him and Tucker and Martin Clunas is I like football, and Dennis as well. It's like, when I don't know anything about it. I have zero interest. I don't care. I don't like it because it's competitive. Winning just stresses me out. It's too much pressure trying to actually win something. That's weird. No, seriously, that is, it just stresses me out. It's like, oh no, even playing cards, it's like, oh no, I have to win. It's that's too much pressure.
Oh no, I used to watch football, but then eventually I just preferred watching grown men fighting their pants for a belt. It's way more fun.
That's normal to me.
Yeah, way more fun. Right, so we'll try and start wrapping up. I've got like half of this I still haven't discussed, but we'll probably have part two.
We'll do part two.
So I'll go for just quickly. How was the Lita Q&A? You were kind of thrust in the last second for that.
See, it was it's bad that I can't remember the name of the promotion.
I know it. I think it was Triple M, was it? And then
was it that?
Okay. I think it was
because they were mainly doing events like darts, and then they started branching out into doing the Q&As with like celebrities and stuff. Okay, and the guy who was running it, I didn't speak to the guy directly. Someone else did, so I don't know but the initial contact, but they were basically look, we're doing this thing. We know you guys are the wrestling guys in Aberdeen. I think the guy is from Aberdeen. He might not live in Aberdeen, but he's from Aberdeen, I think. And that's what he knew us. He said, look, basically, you guys are the wrestling guys. Would you mind hosting it? It's basically like everything's good to go. He said, it'd be a lot easier if we do it because I think you had someone else to do whatever. So, yeah, okay. So I'm thinking, cool, well, no, she shows up. The venue's booked. That venue with all the glass is booked, which is their booking, whatever. Everything's in place. People have got their tickets. We know when it's happening. Cool. So I'm thinking, I'll finish work. I'll head down. Plan was to, because a lot of regulars are going to be there, I was just going to just hang about in a corner, try and be invisible, because it's not like she's here. Go actually look at the proper star, the mega star. Just look at her, because it doesn't matter that I'm here. Just going to sit in a corner. I was going to just sit by the merch table and just watch and just stay out of the way. Fine, sorted. So I get there. I'm there for about half an hour, speaking away to some of the guys already there. And then I get told, the guy who's hosting the night isn't here. So I assumed that it was a package deal. They would come here. She came with a handler and we would have the guy do the night. Well, he didn't show. Now, I didn't know whether he didn't show because he could be bothered. I don't know whether it was never planned in the first place. I don't know. All I know is I'm being told, and it's like half six maybe, whatever time it is, it's scheduled to go out after seven, I guess. It's like, no, we need you to do it because there's no one else here really. Because one, I'm a geek for stuff and I don't remember recent stuff, but old stuff, because I remember everything she's done just through osmosis. I just know. I don't know how. I know about Mexico, so that you went to ECW, or that you came in with SC Rios, and blah, 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 blah. I just do. So I'm being told, well, you need to do it. So it's funny because my girlfriend Charmaine was at the night, and she was freaking out, nervous, because she's waiting to meet Lita. So she's nervous because she's meeting Lita. So she's waiting in the queue, and I said, yeah, webbed her and said, I know how you're nervous, meeting Lita. Yeah, well, I'm doing a night now. It's like, what? She's like, why? Well, the guys are showing up, the guys in here. So what are you going to do? I'm going to make some quick notes, and I'm going to completely wing it. And off I went. So had a brief chat with Lita for a minute, came through, introduced myself. Hi, I'm Scott. I'll be doing the Q&A with you. Is there anything that you don't want to talk about? Then, no, not really. Cool. Well, I've got some bullet points, blah, blah, blah. We'll fill in the blanks. Yeah, I'll see you out there. Off I went. That was it. Did it. One person asked a question that I was led to believe that she wouldn't ask, but she did anyway. So I was raging, but I didn't try and sell it. But I was raging. I think one of the guys that knows me well knew I was raging because my face dropped, but I don't think anyone saw it. It was just, she wanted to ask a question, and I said, well, that's not an appropriate question. Well, I'll ask this one instead. Then she asked that question, and then when she had the microphone, she then asked that question that I told her not to ask because she had the opportunity to. So I don't think Lita was happy, but she didn't sell it, and neither did I. We both kind of agreed to just not sell it and then move on. So that was the only low point of that, was the person kind of went into business for herself, and I didn't appreciate that at all. So that annoyed me. Apart from that, fine.
I really enjoyed that. Lita's Hardy Boys and Lita, they were my guys growing up. So meeting Lita was just amazing. I was super nervous, and I had a Hardy Boys t-shirt on. And
she
asked me, she went, oh, it's a cool t-shirt. And I don't know why I said, I just went, yeah, I couldn't find any ears.
Don't say that.
And I said that to her, and then there was
just say thank you.
Yeah, and there was an awkward pause as she went, and what's your name to sign the I chose the tasteful 8x10, the one that's not in a bikini. And I went, it's Billy. And she started writing it. And again, my brain went, oh, sorry, you can put my name on it. I'm not going to sell it. I just went, well, I can see why she looks...
Now she thinks you're going to sell it.
And she looks mortified. She looks really... I don't know if it's just how her face is, but she looked really annoyed in the picture with me. And when I go back to the conversation I had with her, I go, I'd be annoyed with me as well, because I just went to my favourite ever women's wrestler that, A, I can't be arsed buying your t-shirt, and two, that there's probably a good chance I'm going to sell your autograph on eBay, and three, I got her book signed as well with my name in it, so there was a good chance I'd probably sell that as well. And I'm just like, no, my brain just went, and I just spoke. That's why I very rarely meet wrestlers after shows, because I just speak utter rubbish. Because I just go, oh God, I must say something.
Yeah, I mean, it's difficult when you meet someone who's like an absolute favorite of yours. Like, no, for me, it's about trying to be, trying to be professional without fanboying. I mean, I was kind of like that when I met Hogan. And he's like, well, yeah, you're Hulk Hogan. So, and it's like, oh, okay. It's like, so we're doing this. I think it'd be the same way with like a Steve Austin or Rocky, guys who are like legitimate megastars. But the Hogan was like, oh, it's Hulk Hogan. That's just a normal day where you meet arguably the biggest star of all time, or at least one of. So, but yeah, we just try and be cool, but it's difficult in those situations because you end up making a fool of yourself, as you did there.
That's my worst that I've done. I mean, I've met some wrestlers before that were just didn't want to bother with me, which really upset me. But I was just like, I mean, I've paid I've paid your wages, but like I've paid for an autograph to meet you. At least pretend to like me for that moment. You don't have to like me afterwards. Just that moment. Just pretend
but
to like
again,
me.
Again, in life, you're going to encounter good people. But I know, I'm not saying they're bad people, but you're going to encounter people that, are going to be like that. And wrestlers or not, it's just the same thing, unfortunately. Mm. And I know it's a bad... It always sours you a little bit. I haven't had too many of them, I don't think. Maybe, someone that just didn't care. I'm sure there was. I don't know. Tangent, sorry.
Right. So I think I heard Nova in the background getting you tell that it's almost walk time. So I would get Sandy through, but...
Edinburgh's movement.
But Kelly just arrived home like 10 minutes ago, so that's where she is now.
She's at the door right now. That's her banging.
Yeah, I've got one more question that I was told to ask you, and then we'll leave the rest for a second part, and then we'll do social media stuff. So last question from an anonymous source, I was told to make it. Why do you love The Exorcist 2?
Hold on, hold there 1 second. Hold on, I'm going to get something. Sorry, okay. So, The Exorcist 2, here's my Exorcist 2 t-shirt. Oh, yes. Beautiful. The Exorcist 2 is the worst movie I've ever seen. And you're saying, well, Scott, if it's the worst movie you've ever seen, why would you drop money on getting a t-shirt from Portugal? Because that's the only place that did it for this movie. It's because it's so bad, it's fascinating to me. It's not so bad, it's good. It's not so bad, it's bad. It's so bad, it's fascinatingly bad. Like, all the decisions that they made in making the film are baffling. Everything about it is wrong. The structure is wrong. The dialogue is horrendous. You watch the film asking yourself over and over again, I don't know what's happening. Why is that happening? Is this a dream sequence? Are we in real time? It's awful. It's awful. I had to have the t-shirt.
cool, right. So like I say, I hear Nova, she's one walked. So before we wrap up for this part, where can people find you on social media?
Oh, that's terrible. I don't know my handles. I think it's just at Scotty Swift on Twitter. I'm not really on Facebook just now. It's terrible. It's like, I don't know. I've become a Twitter guy. I never thought I'd be a Twitter guy. But yeah, I mean, Scotty Swift on Twitter, at Scotty Swift, you'll find me on Twitter. I'm quite active in that just now. I don't know. I guess Twitter's where all the cool kids are.
That's where the drama happens.
You're not joking about that. The drama, there's always something happening, or someone said something stupid, or someone said something inappropriate, and it's like, there's a lot. You know, the thing that, there's lots of things about this year that's annoying me, and we're waiting to wrap up. And we'll get part two and maybe talk more about it. There are a lot of white knights just now. There's a lot of people in glass houses. Don't throw stones when you live in a glass house, because you'll end up looking like an idiot.
We'll leave that for part two, because I've got the other things on my list here, which we'll get to in a second part. You going to WrestleMania, Lex Luger. I've got The Simpsons, Monorail, Five Star Wrestling. Your potential of being the first Grand Slam champion in WrestleZone. I've got loads of stuff. Like I said, this is all stuff I just got off the top of my head because I've watched WrestleZone for so long. But yeah. Well, that's the tease. That's the tease for a second part. So we'll figure out time and date for another episode. But yeah, this has been a fascinating episode, and yeah, I think
I've enjoyed this. It's been fun. Well, like I said, I mean, we had a brief sit down in Keith 2016. Remember, was it 15? We were backstage and we had a wee sit down for about 20 minutes.
Yes, I've got that somewhere. It's on the YouTube channel somewhere.
Yeah, and that was the longest apart from during like intervals or meet and greets at shows, that was the longest we've ever spoken until now. So I've really enjoyed having a chance to sit down. And like I said, the lockdown, I haven't really thought too much about it. I mean, I am thinking about wrestling now that we're training and it is non-contact. That's another thing that we can speak about, the whole issues in trying to work around the non-contact thing. It's difficult, but we're making it work. This is the first time I've really, in a long time, that I've just sat and spoke about wrestling, and you've got me kind of excited again. So thank you.
The Keith shows, we are wrapping up before I go into the ones, but the Keith shows, that's got a really close place to my heart, because the year after that was that week my dog passed away. It was you guys somehow got lumped with the task of cheering me up, and even though the pictures don't look like I was cheered up, I had a face like smacked arse, but I actually was, thanks to you guys. So yeah, that was forever in debt. I think that's possibly why I'm so passionate about WrestleZone and that as well. We'll leave that for a second part. We'll talk about more training and I want to find out more about Five Star Wrestling, so I'm excited about that. But
I have a great Five Star story that I haven't really shared apart from the guys that I'm close to. So stay tuned.
Stay tuned. That's going to be amazing. But yeah, thank you very much, though. Look forward to part two.
You're welcome. Thank you, man.